deportation started the 22nd of July 1942, and then representatives of youth organizations got together and they, something has to be done. In October 1942, the organization came to life, an understanding came that some actions in preparing the youth, if another deportation starts, that a response should be in an organized way.
There was a very complicated political situation in the Warsaw Ghetto, because there were so many parties, and the Zionists, right and left, and revisionists, they couldn't get together.
The leadership in the ghetto was the Jewish Council, the Judenrat, but the underground leadership was in the hand of the young people. Abraham Blum was the leader of the Bundesjud group. He was the one also who was responsible, together with the young people there, Marek Edelman, Michal Klepfisch, responsible for organizing the four Bund youth groups in the fighters' organization. They were also the representative together and meet with Potra Anilevich from Shomer HaTzayel. They had four groups. They meet with a representative from other youth groups. And this is how they started to work to coordinate.
Somehow they came together and they formed 22 groups. They called, one was called ZOB, the Jewish Fighting Organization, and the other one was called Irgun Zweile Umi. This was the revisionist, which were the followers of Jabotinsky and Trupeldor.
That because I look like a Polish girl, there are a few others on the other side of the wall. To get out and to walk in the underground on the Polish side, to try to prepare to buy on the black market guns, whatever it's possible, and also to prepare some hiding places for children, if it's possible there, to find out. And this is how I got out of the ghetto.
What was the main thing now? Buy arms. Because they were, the ZOB had 700 people and Zweile Umi had 300. But could they have thousands of young people? But there were no arms. The Polish government in London at that time sent us 50 revolvers with munition, 50 hand grenades, and 4 kilograms of explosive. We bought 4,000 on the Aryan side for money, 4,000 liters of gasoline. So when the tanks attack it, we'll burn it.
The first really response of the organized armed resistance took place the 18th of January, 1943. But this was not too much organized yet. And I would not say that it was very successful, but this was the first attempt. And after it, they came to the conclusion that they have to separate the youth groups.
The ZOB organization, they asked us, they need couriers between the fighting group and the buildings. The ZOB have broken through in cellars between buildings so that you could travel great part of the ghetto without going outside, just between buildings. Also, you could do it on a roof. Stay on a roof and watch what's happening. Are the Germans surrounding the walls? That means another action is coming.
The first night of Pesach, the first Seder, on April 19th, 1943, we get a note, calls from the other side, the Germans are surrounding the ghetto.
Passover night, first Seder, the ghetto surrounded. Ukrainians, they were in the SS also, SS, surrounded like every 10 feet, an SS with a machine gun. We knew this is it. And they called out, with loudspeakers, we should get in the street. Well, nobody went out. Next day, they marched in.
The Muranowska gate next to the Umstrauplatz, a platoon of German soldiers came through the Muranowska street into the ghetto and went to the Muranowska square, singing, you know, the northern people, the Obermenschen, Superman, singing, happy. Now, when they came on the Muranowska street, there were two buildings there with flags. One Jewish flag with the Magen David, and one Polish flag. The boys, the Jewish boys, knew that every bullet has to kill. Otherwise, they wouldn't come out. So when they stopped singing and standing there on the Muranowska square, they came under fire. And it was hell for them, because so many fell. They threw their guns and they ran away.
Squads of 10 to 12 people in different parts of the ghetto, thus simultaneously they cause a lot of damage to the Germans and to the guards.
Now every piece of arms, every revolver, every gun, every submachine guns were collected. That's how the how the underground got submachine guns. There was not one was only in the whole ghetto. And uniforms, everything was collected.
I was assigned a few more boys to organize all ammunition. If one of them get killed, our boys or the German, I should be able to recover the ammunition and bring it back.
We had spies, Jewish spies, on the Aryan side. And the German knew that they won't get us out so simple. They'll have to fight. And they told us how they prepared, the German, what they had against us. Is 2,000 SS soldiers. Listen to this. 3 detachments of artillery. 1,000 of German police. 1,000 of Polish police. And 1,000 of Ukrainians, Lithuanians, Latvians, and Estonians in the black uniforms, the supporting police. Against them, we were 700 fighting organization and 300 in the other organization. But the Germans knew it won't come easy.
Within hours, the artillery and the German tanks, German armor, was moved into the ghetto. And our apartment, because it was the originating point, was destroyed by fire.
2 tanks went on Muranowska Street, on Zamenhofer Street, also from Muranowska Gate on Zamenhofer Street, I'll show it to you, to Mila 8. And there they were waiting for them, 2 tanks. They threw the Molotov cocktails on them.
Yes, come closer. We started to throw Molotov bomb. Made it with other friends. I was small, I couldn't come through. We took a bottle with gasoline, with a piece of thing, and we threw on the tanks and was thrown from the floors from everywhere. They could not come in.
And I remember I saw it through the window. I was not in the bunker yet. How a young man, must have been young because all the people wouldn't have done it, went right to the tank and he threw a bomb inside and exploded.
The tanks came in, got burned up, and half truck, Germans, got shot. I jumped on them, took away the guns, took away the helmet, the knife. I took one helmet away. I scratched the swastika, and I put a David star on it.
So the Germans left. They were scared. They left the ghetto, and they knew they can't fight just on open streets. So they sent planes, and the planes started to bomb us.
General Stroop, the no good mamza, he sent one after another one. We were fighting street by street.
Some of them, there were young girls fighting. We only were fighting at night, because in the daytime we had never a chance.
Every building, there was a bunker. People had to hit, and there was a physician assigned to every bunker.
Brought food where we could find it in the bunkers to them. They asked us, they needed bandages, they need disinfectants, iodine and things for it. There was no medicine per se, but that was the basic things for wounded. We would carry that through.
Then they came in with the tanks, cannons, every building after they set a fire.
Two buildings away from us was burning. The heat and the smoke from that building was so suffocating and so hot that we couldn't stay in this apartment anymore. The smoke was intense. Downstairs, in the yard, there were Ukrainians and Germans with rifles. They were shooting and they were screaming, "People out, people out." We jumped from the third floor windows into the yard, into their arms. But the smoke was so intense and people were jumping from all over the place that they were shooting indiscriminately. And we succeeded to run.
Mila 58 was on fire, we were safe. My brother now was lying dead because the Germans saw him. It was maybe 4 o'clock. They saw him standing, throwing hand grenades to the windows, in which one hand grenade killed him and he was lying there dead.
And I was walking on the street. And the whole city was in flame because the whole city was burning. So many blocks, not one, so many blocks.
People been jumping from the balconies, people been jumping from the windows, they've been burning the streets. The whole city was burning.
Women throwing out the children from the windows. It was unbelievable.
But the worst thing for me was the Easter Sunday, when I was in the church listening to all the sermons of the priest, and I blend in with them together. And I came out, the priest was standing in the front greeting all the parishioners, and they were dressed in their best clothing on Sunday. Most of them took their children to their carousel, which was with music, which was around that. You could see with the naked eye what was going on in the ghetto, the flames and the burning, everything. And you were just listening to the expressions, "Jews are burning," not burning, "Jews are Zitkische Smajo, Jews are frying." I was in that environment of the people. Until today, I cannot understand where did I take the strength not to scream, not to reveal who I am, that I look at my people burning, and I cannot say anything.
Order of the day from Hashomer HaTzair was that we are not going to be taken alive. You know, we are not going to be allowed to take on the transport. And I was all hyped up with it. I knew that this is exactly what I'm going to do. We are not going to go just like that. So there was just a conviction. We are just not going.
Out, we walked 5 hours in the sewer. We went down with 28 people. We came out 6. The others were drowned in the sewer. They were throwing poison gas.
We were between Nalevki and Mila Street. We got out. He told us to keep your hands up, SS. Told us to sit down. maybe 15 of us, was one young lady, and she was wearing, never forget, a big long leather coat. And the young man, and the SS turned on and say, he must be that Ufira. She mustn't see the altar. You must be the leader. That girl, he shot her on the spot.
Marched us off to the Umschlagplatz, a train depot. Put us in the cattle cars. You went to Treblinka.
When the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising took place, our skies were empty. We didn't have any help for anybody. The ghetto went up in flame. And even the free world didn't do anything. Our Jewish people were absolutely isolated and by themselves. And I think that we have to remember this.